conclude this track with our last talk for today, a political talk. After this talk, we have short closing remarks in the other conference room, so please move over swiftly to the other room afterwards. But now, Christo is going to talk to us about implications of functional programming on human rights.
All right, thanks a lot. My name is Christo, and I started working with technology more from a system administrator side. I got very bored of this after a short time. I started doing programming then. It was more exciting than system administration. Since a long time already, I have an interest in like political and social issues. I started off more like on the side of like anti-fascism and housing rights. A few years ago, I more transitioned into like issues around the politics of data, privacy issues, and issues around digital security. So I give trainings, for example, to activists in the field, how to protect themselves digitally, how to protect the people they're working with. And since a few years, I'm transitioning more and more into the area of human rights. In particular, what I do there is like I develop software there. And what is very interesting currently is like the use of data to create investigations in the field of human rights. This is generally true for basically whole civil society, not only the human rights. Data is becoming increasingly interesting. So this is about me a little bit. So where I work is like the human rights mostly. What I like about is like, so the human rights generally understood as like a set of moral principles. They are meant to like give a standard to like how humans should behave with each other. And generally like the human rights expresses like a set of laws and legal rights that people have. So, but then in reality, like I'm not a lawyer and actually like nobody that I work with is a lawyer. So there's something else about the human rights as well. It is not just like a set of legalities. And I think personally that like what is very interesting about the human rights is that at the end it's about like the agency of people and the communities, and that like in the human rights you can give like meaning to the experiences and to the narratives that people have nowadays. So what I do in my daily work is like I develop tools. I use software to write to develop my tools. I don't build physical tools. I build soft tools. And that's a very exciting thing. But primarily, like, I don't see myself as like a software engineer. I don't see myself as like a programmer. I see myself as somebody who builds tools. And these tools have to be like also in a context. Tools are very interesting because actually I think like that the history of technology actually is like the a history of the production of tools. Technology always expresses itself in like the tools that we build around the technology itself. Tools are like also like extend our senses. And like they also limit our perceptions. And we use tools to like transform our environment, to shape our world. But at the same time, while we are using these tools also shape us at the same time. There's a dialectical relationship between like the tools that we're using and the people who create those tools. And this dialectical relationship, I think, goes very far. So, this is like probably one of the most overused quotes you can put on a slide in a computer programming conference, probably right after the two hard things in computer science, naming, and I forgot the other one. But what I like about this one is like, so this talks about like how organizations that build software are reflected in the software, in the artifact they're producing, right? So like the way that like people or teams communicate with each other will define later on how the software will look like, how the software itself will communicate. And what I like about this quote is actually like less the content. That's not so relevant to me. I don't work in big organizations, but like what I do like is this insight that there's like a meta level in which we are working. Like the way that we are like building our tools, there's also like different levels of effects that it has, and we have to look at those as well. So a tool is not only about like a primary function, but there's also a lot of secondary effects that it has. And I think that's a very important one. So for me, for example, like a secondary effect is like the context in which I embed the tool. So will it be running on like Unix? What workflow should it support? Which groups of people are talking are going to use this tool? And I think tools also have an effect of like how people gather around the tool. So people communicate to each other. the world is like organized as like groups, communities that like exist in like some sort of network. And the tools that we're using defines how we can communicate with each other. Like a tool can also like basically structure, like force us to like adopt different types of communication styles. If we put a very centralized tool, we're gonna have like a central point where we talk towards tool. So these are things that I find very, very interesting. And I wanna have like a small use case, which is a project that I'm very, very fortunate that I can collaborate on. The CERN archive is like, it exists for a few years. What they're doing is like they're documenting like the crimes or like the incidents that are happening in the ongoing war in Syria at the moment. What they're doing basically is they're like collecting like a lot of like online evidence, like YouTube videos, tweets, Facebook posts, files that people give them physically, and create like a big database of like things that are happening in Syria at the moment. So every video they're gathering is like one incident, and if you put like multiple videos together, you maybe can create an evidence about something specific that happened. A hospital that got attacked, a gas attack, a school that got bombed, stuff like this. How this looks like is basically, this is like a typical incident report that the Syrian archive is doing. So what you can see here is, first of all, there's like a video that is like a proof that something happened, right? So in the human rights, it's always interesting to first you have to prove that something happened. If there's no proof, then you can talk about it, but like you have to show people that something really happened, a photograph, a statement, some other satellite imagery. So there's a video. It describes what should, what is to see on the video. You can download the file. There's like certain metadata that is interesting. So like what kind of violation is documented? In which collection does it fit? Who gave it to them? Or where did they find it? Like some hash to verify that this is like really the original video that like was posted on YouTube, that it's not tampered with. Although that's a little bit tricky, of course, in practice. And their collection is actually like, so they managed like in the last few years to collect like almost 1.3 million videos like this. In fact, they're like the biggest collection of like documentation about the war in Syria. It's bigger than the ICC, it's bigger than the UN, because they managed to do something that like other big organizations were like not able to do. And now it's also like, not only that they have a big collection documenting this, they also become like an archive actually of like what is happening. So half a year ago, like YouTube took down 500,000 of those videos. So with one, like overnight basically, like half of the whole documentation that the Syrian archive had disappeared from the internet. And the Syrian archive basically was the only one who still had a copy. These collections are very important because like later on, maybe like in 10 years, in 15 years, in 20 years or something, maybe you want to start court cases and like try to prosecute like certain individuals who were involved in this. Or you just want to like use this material in order like to create a policy around like memory and similar things. So these collections are increasingly important. So the CERN archive has a certain workflow. And in my daily work, like I have to look at, like what I find very, very interesting is like to look at workflows of people, to see how people communicate with each other, how can you structure and model these kind of like ideas and communications, and then also like where can you like put a computer to help out with this kind of workflow. So in order to like, so this is basically the methodology of the CERN archive. So it starts with like somebody has to identify sources that are relevant. This can be like a YouTube channel, it can be a Twitter feed, a news agency, maybe like a contact on the ground that like maybe has like a video camera and collects this kind of like data. And then like happens like a collection and have to like preserve this data also in a way that like basically might be able to like be used in court later on. Then there comes like a level of like where you do something with the data, so you either process this into something else. Some of the data, so they have like 1.3 million videos, until now they could maybe like verify 5,000 of those. Verification is a manual process at the moment. Somebody has to look at those videos and basically be sure that like the place is right, the time is right, the incident is like what it is described. Like verified data is something very different than like data. Data is like there are masses on it, but like once you have to start looking into it and actually verify it, it becomes actually very difficult. And analysis is also another thing that they do with it. So for example, like they build dossiers about, for example, hospital bombings. gas attacks, things like this. So then like the analysis of this data becomes interesting. And of course, because like you have to review it. Before you publish it, you have to review it. The problem is like if you build a case based on data, with anything like in the human rights, you have to basically be able to prove every time that you're right, but your adversary has to prove only once that you're wrong. If you're disproven once, your case breaks apart. So the review is a very, very important step, of course. I think this is true for every kind of like data-related activity. I think in the human rights or just generally like in civil societies, this becomes even more so important because of like repercussions that it can have. And then like once it's reviewed, like they publish the data, so on the website there's like this database of like verified incidents, they create dossiers, they write articles about it, make like specific investigations, things like this. So these workflows, I personally am, I love creating like workflows. Workflows is a very, very interesting thing to be looking at because this is like where you actually like interact a lot with people. You have to talk to them, you have to like understand what they're about. And then you can also look at like where you can use a computer for this. So if you look at this, you will see that at the moment around like half of those things are automated, the other half are manual steps. And in like at least in human rights, nobody ever would suggest to take the human out of the loop. It's very, very important that you have this like human that has like a qualitative decision-making power here. So never ever would you try to say like, okay, I take this whole workflow and I just like make some crazy computer program and that will do it for me. Like this is not how it works. You need a human and it's also encouraged to have like the creativity of a human here. But what you can do is like you can use computers to like reduce the labor intensive parts, the mechanical parts, the ones that don't need require any kind of creativity. And for this, like computer programs, of course, like ideal. So when I create tools, there's like certain things that I'm looking in it. And so, of course, like you have the primary thing. Like let's say if I want to have a tool that like collects Twitter feeds, and at the end, the tool has to collect Twitter feeds. So that's like the primary purpose, right? But I'm talking a lot about like the secondary effects that I find interesting. Yeah, and to look at those, like there's a few things that I try to aim. So first of all, like I think tools that you can rearrange while using them are better tools than tools that are just static. Like if I can like basically use a tool and like on the fly do something or change the way I use this tool, that's better. I have to think about like the tool and its context. Where will this tool run? What is like the purpose of it? Who are the people involved? Which organizations will it touch? Which kind of data will it play with? These kind of things. I have to think a lot about like the workflows. What kind of workflow is the group or the individuals using that want to apply this tool? And for me personally, also like I think like tools also have the power to either give us agency or take it away from us. So I think like we should always look at the software that we're writing and look at it and think like, will it give like people more freedom? Will it give it like more agency, or will it like limit this agency? And I think you can find normally tools on the market. They're like basically on a scale, right? On the one side, you have like programming languages. They're like Turing complete. You can do anything with it. Like whatever you want to have, you can build it. But you need like a very high level of expertise. It's expensive. It takes a lot of time. On the other hand, side of the scale, you have like these off-the-shelf products. They're basically tools that just give you like the functionality. And if that's what you want, then it's great. But like as soon as you want something slightly different, there's nothing you can do about it. I think like when you develop a tool, you also have to always think of like where you want to position it on this scale of like available or like tools or like how people can use it. So how does functional programming come into this whole thing? So I think like functional programming plays a part here. For me personally, it's like my tool to build tools, right? I think what I like about functional programming is that it gives me a very strong theoretical device that I can use to then model like basically the reality that the tool that I want to build and like think about it on a very, very different way. So this ability to abstract, I think, is very nice, but like the goal of abstraction eventually has to be like to become concrete again. And I think functional programming has this balance that on one hand, like, it gives you like a very high level of abstractions, but at the other hand, it's also very concrete. The goal is always that, like, in the end, you sit down and like it runs or it does something for you, right? I find this particularly interesting or important because, like, I think that, like, the abstractions that we use in our code affect the way how people can use the software. I think the way we write our code leaks straight into the experience of, like, the users using this kind of software. And this is something that I think we have to think of more. So my favorite device, basically, or my favorite tool is function composition. The most basic one, literally the one that, like, you learn, like, in primary school or something like. With this little thing, I can do a lot already. The funny thing is, like, this is something I can tell anybody how it works, everybody will understand immediately. I can talk about the abstraction that I apply in my code, and I can, like, tell it, even use the same vocabulary partly, and tell it to whoever is using this tool, and this person will understand. I think this is a very, very powerful thing. What I also like about composition as a tool is, like, that in order to compose, I first have to decompose. There's a funny relationship here that, like, in order that I have my building blocks that I can then compose again into bigger ones, I first have to understand what it is and I have to break it apart. This process of, like, breaking things apart creates a lot of clarity in terms of, like, how do I want to model the workflow, what is it that, like, people actually want to achieve. So, and composition gives me this, like, a nice ability, and I think composition also maps to human processes. So people compose, organizations compose, like, there's, like, a certain level of, like, how, like, you have, like, person A that does something and person B that does something, and like, if you want to do C, like, you go to A first and then you go to B and you ask them both to do something for you. Like, this is, for me, again, like, a way of, like, how I use composition as one. Another thing that and you will notice, like, it's not a very technical talk, I like very simple things, so lists. I think lists are the most, the greatest data structure there are. They are so simple, you cannot do it wrong. Everybody understands lists. Again, like, everybody has a shopping list. Takes off the head, sorts it around, takes the tail. Everybody does this. To-do list, same thing. If you take buckets of lists and you call it Trello, you have, like, the Uber productivity tool. Everything is based on a list, and I think lists are so easy to talk about. That, like, whenever I can use a list, I'm very, very happy. I would really think twice to use something more complicated if I cannot express it in a list before. So, based on these, let's say, my personal, like, things, I built, like, I want to talk about, like, a specific tool that I'm building, which is called SugarCube. And I love the word monoidal as well. I think it's a great word to have. So what it does, basically, it's like, it's a way for me to define processes of data acquisition, data transformation. So the CERN archive uses it, for example, to do its data collection. And what it gives me is, like, it's a set of plugins, I call them, but every plugin is basically a function, and there's a very, very small core that basically just, like, composes functions together and runs them. That's basically what it does. So it's very, very basic, it's very bare bone or something. There's around, like, 30, 40 different plugins at the moment that does all different things. The one important thing is that, like, you can combine every plugin or compose every plugin as you wish. It will always work. If it's meaningful or not, it's a whole different question. So is it meaningful to extract EXIF data out of an image before you actually, like, collect images? No, it's not. So, but you can still do it if you want to do it. I think that's an important aspect. So every plugin basically is the equivalent of, like, a function, right? Every function does a thing. Of course, it's like it's most functions have some side effects. I'm cheating a little bit here on the precise semantics, but. So every plugin does one thing, and then basically, like, I can just, like, create sequences of data processes, and that's, like, very, very simple function composition. This is, like, basically the tool that I give to people. This is, like, what the CERN archive also uses. It has plugins like YouTube channel, YouTube download, Twitter feed, file system import, like these kind of, like, defined functions, and then they can just, like, chain, like, big processes out of these, like, small components. And again, like in this program, I use lists everywhere. My data sequences are lists of functions. My data itself is like a list of records. Every function takes a list of records and returns a list of records. So again, like these two little things, very basic abstractions, allow me to go already very, very far. Of course, like in your field, it will be different. In my field, this actually helps me a lot already. So this is like how it looks like. It's a bit small, I'm sorry for this, but it's just like to give you like a little bit of an insight. This is like how it looks like on the terminal when I run it. If you can read it, you will see that like there's like this like starting the Sheets Queries plugin, ending or finish the Sheets Queries plugin, starting the Sex Search plugin, finish the Sex Search plugin. So each basically step in the composition is just like run in sequence. And this is like how you call it. So you call the program, you give it like some queries, that your question could be like a list of Twitter feeds, a list of YouTube channels, search terms, company names, whatever it is that your plugins are looking for. And you give it some configuration, API key, stuff like this. And then basically this is like how you define your data processes. And these are basically just a list of functions. They are like, again, very, very bare bone. I'm exposing the user of this plugin basically also to the mechanics of the software itself. I'm not hiding the fact of function composition. I'm not hiding the fact of lists here. So what is it that I like about this, or what works for me here in this thing? So SugarCube, it's like, again, like it's not Turing complete, it's not a programming language, but it's not off the shelf either. You can rearrange the elements as you go along. Like you can make like an exploratory moment where you just like try different combinations of plugins till you get answers. And once you know what you, how your data process look like, you can codify it. But if you want to write a new plugin, basically writing a new plugin is writing a function that takes an input and returns an output again. I use composition and I use lists. And I can like rearrange my compositions depending on what I need, right? If I look at like Twitter feeds or look at YouTube videos, it doesn't matter, right? But maybe like in all of these incidents, I want to extract maybe the metadata, maybe want to download the images, fetch, maybe run like metadata extraction and like text analysis over it and stuff like this. So I can like keep parts of my pipeline and just like change, for example, like whatever feeds it, or just combine them into one big one. And that's another thing that I find like in terms of practicality is very high. I can reproduce everything I do. Because if you look at here, I can codify these commands, I can put them into a JSON file, I can give this JSON file to somebody, this person can repeat basically the same process that I did to come to this, to my answers. This idea that I can like reproduce the steps that I'm doing in terms of like an investigation is very important, because at the end of the day, when you present like a piece of data as a fact, not only have this fact has to be right, but you also have to be able to show how you got to it. It's an important one, and I think you will see like in the future more and more this idea of like that you can trace back the lineage of your data. So reproducibility of is for me a very, very important thing. So there's a few traps here as well when I develop my tools that I try to like look out for, and like this is like my personal like windmill fight, it's scalability. I think we build our software always with the thought of like that it scales up. Inherently, like in our environment, in the capitalistic realities that we live in, everything is built to scale. Scalability is the primary concern, and it's basically what makes industrialism work or something. But I think there's a few problems with it. So if I define scalability as the ability to expand the project without having to change its elements. So for example, if I have a company and I want to have a scalable company, I organize my company in a way that I can expand without having to restructure my company. Right? If I have like a scalable research project, I can't accept data that doesn't fit the framing assumption already. If I have a tool that is scalable, I cannot basically have the experience that I have, or like the results I get out of using these tools, inform the functioning of the tool itself. because the tool is built for scalability, I cannot like basically like add this new information, this relation that I receive by using it. And I think this is a problem. So I think like that at the end, because like scalability doesn't allow me to act to the environment that I'm in, that like basically at the end it stops me from creating like diverse tools. It stops me from being in a diverse group because it creates like very single-minded things or views. And I think that like maybe it's maybe easier in my field because it's very small. But I think there's also like a point to be made that we have to maybe start thinking about like non-scalable projects. How can we build the software in a way that like that instead of like it's built for like running on 100,000 servers or something, that basically like adapts itself to like whatever specific need a user has, for example. I think there's more there. I think it's very easy in my field because like the human rights sector is very small. I know everybody who uses my tool personally. It's very easy for me, of course, to build these kind of tools. But I think maybe we have to think about like how to scale non-scalability. Let's see. Another thing that I think that is very often the case is that people think of technology as a sort of techno-fix. I have a problem. I present some technology to fix the problem. And I think the thinking is very flawed. I think every technology creates a lot of problems, and very often like you only focus on the features of the technology, you never look at the downside. What does it mean? So data science, for example, I find it like a very, very interesting case, because on one hand, like it offers a lot of solutions to problems that people say it fixes, might be true, but I'm looking at data science and I say like, wow, the computational power necessary to run this is basically at the moment destroying this planet as well, right? The power consumption needed to do bitcoins and this like neural networks, they have a price and we are paying it, maybe not now, but very, very soon. I think looking then through this lens, you also have to value the technology you're using. Is it actually like fixing the problem, or is it just like just fixing the problem and creating you like 20 new ones? And technology very often does it. I think a lot of problems also that I encounter are actually less of technological nature, but they're more like of problems of workflow, of process, of expertise, of lack of resources. So looking forward, so I put back this like workflow map again, and there's like this one thing here, for example, verification, that at the moment the Syrian archive still does manually. And I think there's like, for example, like more chance to like add more like automated support to like the work that the Syrian archive does. And I think verification is like the thing that I'm looking at next. There's actually also need, so people are really asking for something like this. And the idea is that like if you look at like how you verify data, and this is specifically now for the Syrian archive, so what they do is, for example, say like, okay, I want to have like all the videos that are maybe like from a specific area or from a date or like, I don't know, like contain the word a gas attack or something like this, and like I import this kind of data. So maybe like I get out like 5,000 videos, let's say, right? And I put it somewhere that like as a collection. So the steps of verification, first I import this data, somebody's verifying this, there's like a horde of like people looking at these videos and basically trying to verify every piece of data. And maybe it's decided to be like irrelevant, or maybe it's not verifiable, there's like too little information about it. Or it gets verified and then it moves off somebody else's second pair of eyes is to sign it off. And again, this person can then either say like it's irrelevant, or say like no, it's not verified well enough, like put it back. Or says like okay, it's fine, and then like we export the data and maybe put them into a collection of like verified videos and stuff like this. So if I look at this, what I see, of course, is like the very obvious one. It's like a state machine, right? It's just like different things I can just like move around. And again, like this is like an abstraction that is like that I can use, but I think like I should not hide this abstraction. I should like expose the user directly to this abstraction. Let the user use the state machine directly and like not cover it up. So this is like what I'm gonna do next around my tool and around like the Syrian archive. In between these state transitions, of course, like again, each of these arrows is like a data process. Again, it is a list of functions that basically just define like what is happening in this transition and that is like decomposed into like single steps. So the conclusions for me is, I think that like if we build software, tools, software, anything, I think we should also consider like the secondary effects that it have, and maybe like also say like, okay, these secondary effects are actually like, they should be first class. Like there's like something that we can control about it, maybe there's something that we can like steer in the right direction, and we should not ignore them. Like everything that we do also has like a slew of like different consequences. I think that the abstractions that we use directly in our code will have a direct effect of like how the people are able to use the software that we are writing. And I think like if I say like I want to give agency to people, I think the opposite of agency is alienation, and people are very alienated from the tools they're using very often. And I think this is a problem, and we are not thinking enough about like how we can like work on this. And I think like this is maybe like a way to think about it, that like maybe we think about the abstraction, we think about like how people would like deal with this abstraction, what it means like in a human context. And again, like, and the last thing is like, it's that like composition and decomposition are like my favorite tools to use. I think there's like much more in there than what I showed you or what I'm using until now. But in the end, I think like by doing this process of like decomposing and composing again or something, it also gives me a vocabulary that I can use to talk to people. And some of this vocabulary will be the same that I use like in functional programming. Some of it will come out of mathematics. Some will basically just have different words for the same meaning. But at least it is something that I can use to actually talk to the people that are going to use my software. And I think there's a lot of value in this. So thanks a lot. That's it. Yeah, so what are reports that that the Syrian archive did? So for a while, like what was interesting is like to prove how systematic gas attacks in Syria actually are. So in the media in the West, we only hear about it as like isolated incidents. But if you look, if you have like a lot of data and you can look at it like in terms of like recognizing patterns, you can see that actually there's like that there was like a strategy behind the use of gas in Syria. So also in a military way, so I'm not on top of it, but if I remember right, like I think there was like a correlation of like the occurrences of like cluster bombing, gas attack, and then the infantry basically marching into a place. So there was like a systemic use of this kind of like weaponry. Another one is like the target of civilian, like the bombing of civilian targets, particular hospitals. This is still going on. Also like, I don't know if you follow the news, but like in the last days, again, like there's a lot of talk about like bombing of civilian targets. So that's also another report that the Syrian archive did to basically show like where hospitals got bombed, how often it occurred. The work, like luckily I don't do the verification, I'm very happy about it. I'm happy to abstract this kind of thing far away so I don't have to look at the videos. Some of them are not very nice to watch. There's like a lot of volunteers working around it in Syria, but also for example like people at universities trying to verify this video. So I guess there's like in total probably 20, 30, 40 people trying to verify this stuff. It varies. It depends also a lot on like funding, but most of them are volunteers. It's a lot of work. So if I say like, okay, they collected like 1.3 million videos, right? Of those, maybe like 4,000, 5,000 videos are verified. So that's like a fraction. It's just too much data. The interesting thing is that like if you do database investigations, that as soon as you start, like your problem before you start is like, I don't have the data. As soon as you press enter, your problem is like, I have too much data. Like like your problem immediately changes. It's a very interesting aspect of like using data in investigations.
Have your reports have any impact?
That's the golden question that the whole civil society always has. I want to think yes. I mean, clearly nobody has been brought to court. It's also not like my aim to do this with my work. I don't think that the Syrian archive has this as its primary goal as well. But there is some I would say there's definitely some success because it gives like a, again, as I said, like it gives like a narrative to like the experiences of people. I think that's a very important one. There might be something that comes later, so I know that like the UN is actually interested in this collection of the Syrian archive, so I think they want to have it. So maybe the UN is then using it in like court proceedings, maybe, I don't know. I think like from what I understand is like that also for a lot of people who are, for example, like in Syria, it's like also like they want to publish this kind of data. Maybe that's like the only effect it has, I don't know.
The steps in your workflow that have to be done by humans,
mm-hmm.
is that reflected in the tool, in Sugar?
No, so basically, if I go back to this, each one of them, so there are some intertwining, but actually like each step is really like autonomous. So the whole goal with it is also that like actually this whole thing can be done manually as well. So you don't need any kind of like software in order to do the workflow, right? But of course, like if you only do it manually, maybe like instead of having 4,600 verified videos, you maybe have like only 200. Right, so the idea is only like to use computers like to enhance the abilities of people, not to replace it, and to take away like the mechanical stuff, the stuff that like that is just like error prone and like annoying to do anyway. The manual steps there, like partly. So for example, like what does SugarCube does is, for example, like take from the collection and like I use SugarCube then to like put it into like a Google Sheets, and the Google Sheets is then like what people use to verify the data, right? And then like there to verify it, I can like edit the data, and then I use SugarCube again to read it out from the Google Sheet and put it like in a database or into a CSV file or like move it into a different state of my process, right? So for me, this like the use of SugarCube should only be like, I find it like, so the resources in the human rights sectors are very scarce. Like it's like, there are not the salaries, like nobody's, like you don't make money there, like nobody talks about IPOs and disruptions and stuff like this. It's a whole different field, right? So it feels like for me developing in this area, in the human rights, it feels very often like surgical interventions. Like you do very small things that have to be like very, very precise because you just don't have the resources to do big things. But actually, I think there's a lot of value there as well, like to think about technology in this like surgical thing of like just like look at like every part of your big picture and say like where does it matter the most and where do you get the most out of it.
If you make one error, can it be that everything of your work is discredited?
Well, I mean, if you build a case, right? So let's say you write an article for a newspaper and then you present, like, in this article, you present, like, 10 different facts, right? If you get, like, one thing really wrong, then, like, the rest of the article becomes, like, doubtful, at least, right? It's easy.
I understand the fact, but I just wanted to know if you have some kind of recover from something like this, but it can happen.
I mean, for sure you can recover. You can use the 9 good facts and still like also in other work, or like the rest is not affected by it. But then like if you say like you build a case, it's also always like a political conflict, right? Like you have an adversary and there's like a game, like a political thing happening as well around it. So if you make a mistake, you become like very vulnerable for the rest of your work as well. You have to be like very precise in what you state. I mean, you want to, not everybody has to. So I think, of course, like it's a very absolute statement and maybe I should weaken it a little bit or something. I think like personally, I think like it's like where we should start in our work is like that we try to like really achieve this like a very, very strong cases to reduce the amount of like possibilities for other people to attack you on your work, basically. Yeah.
But if I understand right, it's just you verify these facts and there are two persons which are probably not connected. So
there's two stages, right? So there can be multiple people behind it. So there's two stages. If it's like always one person for each stage or multiple, that's depending on like the organization running it.
But if ever you have two persons which want to hurt you, then they could both verify effect, which didn't happen, and then you have someone else publishing this in a newspaper, and then you lose all your reputation.
There's a chance there, right? I'm not sure, but I think it might happen, yeah. I mean, I think so far the CERN archive has no track record of wrongly verified data, but maybe also nobody looked that closely at it. It's like in an adversarial system, and the human rights court system, for example, is an adversarial court system, right? If you're accused of a crime, you have the right to dissect the evidence against you, right? And you can basically create reasonable doubt about how valid this type of evidence is. So again, I would weaken inside my statement and say it's at least bad for you if you create a report or you produce an investigation and you base your findings on facts that can be disproven. In this case, it's somebody from the organization. So there's a few people who are permanently involved, and there's a lot of volunteers. So the CERN archive, how I understand it, it's there's a few people who are permanently working on it, and there's a lot of volunteers around it that help out with it, right? And the CERN archive basically has no crowdsourcing approach towards verification. But there have been in the past other projects, Amnesty International ran the Decoder project, where they basically had 45,000, 50,000 people helping out with verification of data. You can find it online, Decoder Amnesty, and then you find more. So they verified data about oil spills in Nigeria. It was three or four different things that where they had a lot of data and people tried to verify it for them. And that was a crowdsourced approach to it. The CERN archive didn't take this route, to my knowledge. Again, I want to say I'm not part of the CERN archive. I'm collaborating with them on this kind of things. The development of the methodology, that's their work. What I then do is I look at it and I try to make it easier. Yeah.
Thank you very much for
your
insights in your